inviting me to give this keynote talk and indeed to become a Vebleo fellow. So yes, I'm George Gibson at the University of Connecticut. I'd like to start off with just saying that this work can't be done alone. The two graduate students had a big role in this are Dr. Li Feng, who's now a professor at the University of Central Florida, and Dr. Ryan Coffey, who's a staff scientist at the LCLS, the ultra-fast free electron laser at Stanford. And this work has been funded by the NSF AMO division for quite some time. So this session is on science, engineering, and technology. And it's quite exciting to see keynote talks from a variety of different fields. We don't usually get to see such a mixture of different areas of science. But I kind of did have to ask, why am I in this session? The other talks are a bit overwhelming in the interesting applications that everybody is working on. I'm much more towards the very basic side of the science. And so I hope I don't have to convince the audience of this, that advances in science, engineering, and technology are driven by basic fundamental research. So that's definitely where my group is at. It's also important to keep discovering strange things about quantum mechanics. For some reason, we just can't really intuitively understand quantum mechanics. And it means as you keep probing it, more and more strange things come up, which we wouldn't have expected. So quantum mechanics turns up in a huge variety of fields. Our particular tool is short pulse, high intensity laser pulses. And despite the fact that we're at the very basic end of research, I want to discuss two experiments where we found new quantum phenomena and show how this may lead directly to some potential applications. So to get started, if you're not used to the field of high intensity lasers, just kind of give an overview. The last few decades have given us great control over lasers and electric fields to where we can produce just a huge variety of intensities. So at the low end of the range, you have the linear regime, which is like sunlight, simple helium, neon lasers, laser pointers, that sort of thing. Let's see, maybe I'll try and use my virtual laser pointer here. As you turn up the intensity, you start getting into nonlinear optics where you can get second harmonic generation, difference frequency generation, that sort of thing. You have to start using perturbation theory. As you crank up the intensity more, you get into this multi-photon ionization regime where basically we can ionize any atom or molecule or certainly any material. As you keep going, you get up into this red regime where relativistic effects start coming in. The electrons are driven so hard, they become relativistic. People are actually talking about the vacuum polarization, that the vacuum itself is a dielectric, and at extremely high intensities, that starts to matter. And then one of the huge goals of all of this is actual pair production, electron-positron pairs produced directly from the vacuum with the very high intensity laser. And this would be the first experimental observation of nonlinear quantum electrodynamics. And so that has the theorists very excited because there actually is no real method, tractable way of dealing with nonlinear QED. And so if we could actually do experiments in this region, that would be a really fundamental breakthrough. So just briefly, how do you make high intensities? Intensities area, energy per area per time. Energy is basically just expensive. If you want more energy, you just need to invest more money in the laser system. The area, you can focus a good laser beam down to a square wavelength. and there's not much more you can do there. But the time, you want to make the pulse as short as possible. So a huge effort in the last few decades has gone to making extremely short laser pulses. It's gone from picosecond to femtosecond. Now attoseconds are fairly routinely generated. And so that's where you can really win in producing very high intensities. But with a modest solid state laser system, like you could have in a university lab with not much trouble, if you put 1 millijoule into 10 microns squared in 30 femtoseconds, you get up to 3 × 10^16 watts per centimeter squared. And to put that back on our scale here, that lands about here, which corresponds to one atomic unit of electric fields. In other words, the electric field produced that an electron sees in a hydrogen atom. So this is definitely non-perturbative. We're putting the atoms in a very unusual environment. And in fact, you may recall this was so significant, it was awarded the Nobel Prize in 2018 to Donna Strickland and her advisor, Gerard Mourou. And it was just exciting because she's the second woman to get a Nobel Prize in physics. And we happened to be graduate students about the same time in the 80s when this was done. Her group got the Nobel Prize. Our group went a different direction, which didn't turn out to be quite as impressive. And so now there's almost no limit to the intensities we can produce. So what do we do? We expose atoms and molecules to high intensity laser pulses. And we were interested in the vacuum ultraviolet fluorescence because it would be an indication that you can produce highly excited states of atoms or molecules. And we had reasons to believe this would be the case. And indeed, when you look at the VUV fluorescence spectrum of nitrogen, you see it's a rich spectrum, many different lines. The nice thing about VUV spectroscopy is from the line, you can actually identify both the upper and lower states of the transitions. So you can really learn a lot about what is really going on. It turns out we are producing states that lie up to 20 EV above the ground state, which can then radiate. And this is very intriguing because our laser photons are only 1.55 EV. So we're talking about 20 photon transitions, which is very unexpected. And it was also interesting, it only came from molecules. If we put atoms in like argon or something like that, we saw virtually no radiation. So there's some coupling with diatomic molecules, which can produce very high levels of excitation. And so this is, you know, what we've been interested in for quite a few years, is producing real bound-bound transitions on highly excited states with many photons. And not bound free transitions, which is ionization, or virtual transitions, which is harmonic generation. And the reason is, if you could get many optical photons to act as a VUV or X-ray photon, that would be very interesting because optical photons are very cheap, X-ray photons are very expensive. And we could start controlling processes at very high energies with optical photons. So, but why is this unlikely? Well, if you have a two-level system, you can drive a one-photon transition very easily, and you can get Rabi oscillations, things like that. So we're very familiar with one-photon transitions. If you even go to a three-photon transition, as you raise the intensity high enough to drive the transition, you start getting AC Stark shifts, which shifts the levels in and out of resonance, and you can't really produce a lot of population transfer. But so what's so special about diatomic molecules? And in fact, what's so interesting about charged diatomic molecules, with these lasers, we can easily ionize and say remove 4 electrons. If you look at the structure of this, there's going to be a covalent ground state where you have electrons evenly split between the two atoms, and that would dissociate in a charge symmetric way. But you have a pair of ionic excited states where you have two electrons on one side and nothing on the other side. Then you can have a Garrada and Ungerada combination of these. So you end up with a ground state here, a covalent ground state, and a pair of nearly degenerate, highly excited states. These two states are very strongly coupled to each other because you're basically moving two electrons across the molecule, which will have a very strong dipole moment, and a very weak coupling to the ground state. So if you extract this into a simple level diagram, you have a three-level system of a ground state weakly coupled to a pair of degenerate, strongly coupled states. And it turns out this three-level system had actually never been studied before. Oddly enough, we kind of discovered the system simultaneously to another theory group in Europe, and our papers actually just crossed. So it's funny how the same idea will suddenly appear in two places at once. In any case, you can write down the equations for this pretty simply. You can just put it in your computer and run it. And under these conditions, where the coupling in the upper state is much greater than the coupling to the lower state, and the energy difference is much bigger than the photon energy, you can solve exactly for the n photon Rabi frequency, which I won't go into. I'll just give the physics. This pair of strongly coupled upper states, they beat together with a DC Stark shift, and it's basically a very efficient modulator, and you produce a whole virtual set of levels separated by a photon energy. And then you only need to weakly couple your ground state to the lowest rung on the level, and you can get these multi-photon transitions. Since this is a DC Stark shift doing the modulation, you don't actually have any AC Stark shift, and so you can maintain a resonance with the system even at high intensities. And that's what's so interesting about this. Well, this is, didn't want to get too much into the mathematics, but basically in our system, there are two terms, the coupling in the upper state, the coupling in the lower state. This upper term controls the multi-photon coupling. This term describes the AC Stark shift, and we can separate them. So we can have strong coupling with weak AC Stark shift. Whereas with just a two-level system, there's only one parameter. And so to get strong coupling, you need a strong AC Stark shift, and that ruins the process. So in fact, you can simply drive a five photon transition. If you drive it harder, you can see Rabi oscillations. And in fact, if you sweep through the transition, you can get something called adiabatic rapid passage, where you can get virtually 100% population transfer on a five photon transition, which is unprecedented in the field of coherent control. And so the one other thing, I just have a minute left here for the first half. If we can do this, we can put population in these two levels, but these two levels will dissociate at different rates. And if you let them go, you can get to a point where you would have a pure population inversion on the upper state. And this is very much how an excimer laser works. And so we have hopes that we can actually produce a VUV laser out of this in an excimer-like system. This was actually seen in a totally different field, persistent currents in superconducting loops, but I will actually skip that. So the other place we stumbled totally inadvertently across another novel quantum phenomenon was in the vibrational spectroscopy of molecules using these ultrafast high intensity lasers. So if you put something like iodine in our system, and you first put in a pump pulse and then put in a probe pulse, you look for the ionization fragments, you get this beautiful looking data here. I'll just zoom in. There's an awful lot going on in this spectrum or in this data. You have these lines which represent dissociation, and the different tracks represent different ionization states. But everywhere you see this very strong modulation, and that was totally unexpected. We didn't know where it came from. But as we examined it, and we looked very closely at the vibrational frequency, and in fact, the first derivative of the vibrational frequency, we could unambiguously identify it. That these vibrations came from the known vibrational frequency of the ground state of neutral iodine. In fact, we could get it so precise, we could see that the iodine was at a finite temperature because it was at room temperature. So this is very odd. We're seeing a vibrational signature of the neutral ground state molecule. So it meant the first pulse couldn't ionize it, otherwise we wouldn't see the neutral. And the question is, how did it produce these vibrational oscillations, because it's not resonant with the iodine. So it's possible you can have impulsive Raman scattering to produce excitation, but it's going to be a very weak process for various reasons. It's also called bond softening, but we didn't really expect that to be a strong method of producing vibrational excitation. But another group had seen similar vibrations in deuterium, and they actually identified what the mechanism is. It's something called Lausfranc. So if you have a diatomic molecule, and then this axis is internuclear separation, if your ionization rate depends on internuclear separation, when you ionize this molecule, the outer part of the wave function will ionize first, and the inner part will not ionize. So this is a pure quantum, single quantum wave function. But when you ionize it, you take different parts of the wave function differently. And so you deplete the wave function here, but not here. So now what's left over, the part which isn't ionized, is now not in an eigenstate. And so you'd have to, it gets projected on a series of excited vibrational states. And so this thing starts vibrating. So when you ionize the molecule, the part which wasn't ionized starts vibrating. And that's just, again, took us a while to get our heads around that. You can actually unambiguously tell the difference between this Lausfranc, this new phenomena, and the bond softening or impulsive Raman scattering by the phase of the oscillations. And we could measure the phase very accurately in the experiment, and it was unambiguously this Lausfranc. But it was still very confusing because it was first seen and identified in deuterium, but it was a very weak signal in deuterium, say a modulation of, perhaps 10%. Whereas in iodine, we got a modulation, a huge modulation of 60%. But the strange thing is deuterium is vibrationally cold at room temperature and iodine is vibrationally hot. But we're producing coherent oscillations, and everything in coherent control theory suggests that you want to start as cold as possible in a single quantum state so that you can move you can control it better. It's not supposed to work at high temperatures, but we see just the opposite. We see bigger coherent oscillations at high temperature. And the intensity dependence is also unusual. As we increase the intensity, the average R of the molecules decreased, which meant we also had cooling. So it's a very odd system. But what we have come up with is, if you have a hot molecule, you have an incoherency of thermally populated vibrational states. And then you actually just create a hole in that sea of incoherent states, but the hole is coherent and it vibrates coherently. And in fact, the hotter the temperature, the more it can vibrate. So we had to go into whole density matrix approach here because we had to do it at thermal, in a thermal system, but we'll not go into that unless there happen to be questions. So the question is, what can we do with this? So besides just being yet another odd quantum phenomenon, what we're doing is creating a coherent vibrational oscillations in a thermal ensemble of molecules, but there's nothing special about our laser pulse. It's a generic near IR laser pulse, which has become very common these days. There's no resonance with the molecule, but with pump probe techniques, we can measure that vibrational frequency as accurately as we want. And so we can now get a vibrational spectrum of a molecule in the fingerprint region, which is in the kind of medium to far infrared, but we don't need any light in the far infrared like FTIR spectroscopy. And what's more interesting is we can measure these vibrational frequencies with the sensitivity of ion detection because we're doing it through ionization. So if you compare that with standard FTIR, there you need a light source in the far infrared and you need an optically thick sample, which often means you need a lot of your target molecule. But we can do it with extreme sensitivity and with just, as I say, kind of at this point, generic ultra-short pulse laser system. So why is this so interesting? Well, in talking with a pharmacy professor, it turns out typical biological samples like urine contain hundreds of trace unknown compounds, which may be useful for medical diagnostics, or in fact, just understanding how the body processes nutrients and what comes out. So in pharmacy, they use very high resolution mass spectroscopy to observe this. But even if you know the mass extremely accurately and even get the chemical formula, there's still thousands of possible isomers for any particular chemical formula. So I asked, well, what if we could get the IR spectrum for you? And he said that would basically solve the problem because there are tables and tables of IR spectra of different molecules, which you could match up to. Or in fact, if you have a given structure, you can predict the IR spectrum. So basically, if we could get the IR spectrum in the fingerprint region, we could identify the molecules. We can also do it with very low level concentrations like femtomolar concentrations because we do it through ionization. So you may not all be so familiar with this world of high intensity laser physics, but so I have given you two examples here. So we've analyzed a novel three-level quantum system present diatomic molecules. The high intensity laser pulses can populate highly excited states, and this may lead to a novel class of lasers in the vacuum ultraviolet region of the spectrum, which would be useful for many time domain spectroscopies. We also stumbled across this R-dependent ionization of molecules, which creates coherent vibrational motion, not just in a ground state molecule, but in a thermally populated system. And it may lead to a highly sensitive technique to identify trace molecules in biological samples. So I'd like to thank you for your attention. And this is where I'm at and my email address if you have any interest in learning more about this. So I'd like to thank you again for your attention.